Have you ever seen a computer inkjet printer print out an entire road sign? Look at this here, it's called a traffic jet. It's like a gigantic inkjet printer. Try to stick one of those on your office table. So forever and ever, they made big highway signs like this. Take a big flat surface, paint it green, and then these thick plastic letters that basically last forever. There aren't very many of them left in the country because, well, they're kind of hard to see at night. So you see these little beads on here? These capture a driver's headlights and return the light back to them. And so it's a way of kind of being able to see what the sign says. It's a really weird looking effect. These signs started to go away because back in the 1980s, chemical engineers came up with a better idea.
So instead of glass buttons, retroreflective sheeting was invented.
Mo Madar works at one of the companies that thought there had to be a better way. What if instead of just a few points returning light to the driver, the entire material the sign is made out of returned light to the driver?
Today for certain applications, so...
There are two big companies that make this retroreflective sheeting. The 3M company out of Minnesota, and where I'm at today, Avery-Dennison.
One of the biggest rolls of stickers you'd ever find yourself buying. These set you back about $500 to $5,000 a roll, depending on the grade of the material. That only comes out to be a few dollars a square foot, but road signs are huge, so you're gonna use a lot of it.
Retroreflective sheeting is pretty neat technology. For instance,
you've probably seen this fluorescent color on a school zone sign, and it's certainly not a pigment that exists in nature. It turns out they take ultraviolet light, slow it down, and it falls into the visible spectrum. So we see that and go, well, that's weird. What's that? And that helps us pay attention to it.
How all retroreflective sheeting returns energy from your headlights back to your eyes is complicated but really cool technology, which we'll talk about coming up in the next video. 3M and Avery are suppliers. They don't manufacture road signs, but there are thousands of companies around the country who use their supplies to fabricate road signs, and traditionally they've had three choices of how to do it. The first, stacking layers on top of each other.
Sheeting on sheeting. In which case you would take green sheeting and then you would cut your legend out from white sheeting and you would basically just adhere it, put it on aluminum, put it on your guide sign.
The downside? Well, you wasted a lot of material cutting out those white letters.
The other way you may want to make a sign is similar to how silk screening for t-shirts is done. So you would basically put your white sheeting on a table, you would pour your ink on the mesh, and then you would squeegee that across the design.
Which makes a huge mess, so you probably don't want to use this for making one sign.
Super high volume signs like your stop signs. A fabricator may want to produce 1,000 at a time. But let's say I just need to make one stop sign real quick because they got a sign that got knocked down. They need it right now.
You can use a process called overlay. Start with white retroreflective sheeting.
You would take a translucent red film, cut out the word stop out of that, and then you would put that on top of white sheeting.
And it's that process that fan of the channel Charlie Davidson used when he made this for me. Isn't that neat? So he started with a white piece of retroreflective sheeting that he put on the metal, and then has this sticker here that goes on top that's translucent that changes the white appearance to green, then cut a circle in that, and then cut out a blue one that fit just perfectly inside that circle, and then has negative space here that he cut out of the blue that goes back to that base white layer. That's a lot of work. It shows he has a very steady hand and a lot of talent to pull that off. Somebody clumsy like me, the sign would not look nearly this good.
But what if you want to do something that's really fancy and graphical? Imagine cutting all of that out piece by piece. When it's on paper, we run down to the office supply store, buy an inkjet printer and some overpriced ink, and let the computer be the artist. Now you can do the same for road signs.
You would take your stop sign, send it to the printer, and the printer would just print it on your white sheeting for you.
And this,
oh wow, look at that print head,
is what that looks like.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. So,
which floats along on top of gigantic magnets,
is what's driving that head back and forth, sort of like your high-speed rail.
And using a special translucent ink, it prints directly onto one of those gigantic rolls of white retroreflective sheeting. Your inkjet printer at home uses four colors, cyan, magenta, yellow, and K, which is black. Traffic jet printers use ink that's the exact color the road sign needs to be, the right blue, brown, yellow, red, green.
And with a large printer like this, you could actually print your guide signs to your stop signs to anything in between. A 6 foot wide sign, your material is only 48 inches, and so you would basically have to use two rolls of material and splice them together.
Can it print both reels at the same time?
It can, yeah.
Oh, wow.
He tells me the Traffic Jet Pro is rated at 630 square feet per hour, which I calculate to be 16 pages per minute, so about the same as an office printer. The big green light telling us all clear.
You're not going to knock yourself out if you walk in front of that printhead.
There's this pole cable, looks like one you'd see on a bus.
Your emergency stop, safety first.
But fresh off the printer,
it's kind of rough.
It's not quite ready to be a sign.
For this whole thing to work is you actually need the light to enter uniformly and for it to come back uniformly. You would basically take that roll, you'd bring it here, and then you would basically apply a clear overlay.
Remember back in third grade when your teacher would laminate your art project? It's that, but big.
You want to put a clear overlay on it, and the clear overlay does a couple of things. One, it gives you that glossy surface. It's a layer of adhesive flows on that rough surface on a raw print, where light can enter the material uniformly on a glossy surface and then exit it uniformly. So you can really see that gloss come through now, especially on the black material.
The second job of this clear outer layer.
Find a permanent marker? We're looking for a permanent marker.
Protect the sign from nature.
A standard acrylic overlay.
And mankind.
Or an anti-graffiti film.
And with the right chemistry, it wipes off just like an infomercial.
Here's my call today.
You call now.
What you have here is a material that liquid doesn't really like. And so when you get the spray paint or marker on there, the material, the ink will actually bead up. It actually allows you to wipe it off pretty well. Yeah, this would be a sign blank, so.
Then, like a big sticker, you put it on a piece of metal, and it becomes a sign. So let's go all the way back to the beginning and start over and actually make one.
But you can't, like, squish the font.
A sign begins life as a document on the computer.
It's kind of fun with the Avery-Dennison thing on there, though.
Yeah, you'll remember us.
Yeah.
So you literally just pick a printer just like you would on a normal computer.
Exactly, yeah.
Being bigger and hotter, it takes a little longer to warm up.
If you look in here, there's this area where all these kind of the circles are. And it is a heater as well. You know, the amount of ink that we put down, at the speed that we put down, it wouldn't dry with just this dryer. We have this additional dryer on top.
Once everything is ready, the print head flies back and forth like a more complicated version of your inkjet printer at home, which means it's time to put it in the big laminator.
Barely paying attention and boom, it's wrapped.
Now we could cut it out with scissors, or use this really fancy and expensive cutting machine. Computer instructions from the print job guide sort of a fancy razor blade that runs across this gray fuzzy mat. I say it's kind of fluffy like a toothbrush, or the knife can cut the retroreflective sheeting and slide around on that mat without, you know, cutting up the mat. This gives them a perfect cut every single time.
That's it, it's done, huh?
Now we can carry our big retroreflective sticker back to mount it on a piece of metal.
So we cut the sign to the size that we already had our aluminum cut to. Liner on the back. So I just kind of lined it up with my hands. Bring our pressure roller over. Clamp it down and just give it a quick roll. And then I will just take the liner off. And then I'll just tuck it under, roll it over. Now half the label, half the sign is applied. And I'll just take the other half. That's it.
It's a sign now?
Sign now.
It looks like a road sign.
As always, Avery-Dennison didn't pay me anything to make this video today. You paid for it thanks to your contributions at patreon.com/roadguyrob, where normal people just like you, cool normal people just like you, kick in a few bucks each month so I can come to Chicago and show you about how they can make a printer that prints a road sign. Full disclosure, they were having a party, so I ate a little bit of their lunch and, almost dropped it, this souvenir that they made for me, which it's my sign named Checkers. No, I'm going to keep them. Let's see you next time.
It was a little Cocker Spaniel dog and our little girl named Checkers. And I just want to say this right now, that regardless of what they say about it, we're going to keep it.
Wait, so if I keep the sign, I'm like Nixon. 22 years from now, I have to resign the U.S. presidency. Yeah, maybe if we kept Nixon busy making road videos, he wouldn't have been a crook.
Well, I'm not a crook.